Before we begin, I just want to say that we'll be talking a lot about madness, in quotes, as it is used in Shakespeare's Hamlet, which doesn't really have any bearing on real-life mental illness. So the content warnings for kind of insensitive descriptions of mental illness. And also worms. People often point to Dungeons & Dragons as the first mainstream role-playing game, since Gary Gygax's 1974 product has now become synonymous with TTRPGs and their modern understanding. One could go back to 1824, to the Prussian Kriegsspiel, one of the first realistic war games which simulated military maneuvers by moving little blocks around a map, to make a claim about gaming's earliest origins. But I think that is too easy, to limit the medium of games to tables and dice. For us to really understand what it means to embody a role, we should go back to one of the oldest art forms in human history. I'm speaking, of course, about theater. It's almost impossible to know exactly when humans started pretending to be other people for entertainment. Our innate drive to imagine and play is likely older than our ability to put words to the page. But you need look no further than the theatrons of ancient Greece, or the passion plays of ancient Egypt, dating back some 4,000 years ago, to understand that the impulse to pretend is deeply ingrained in human history. These days, role-playing games, especially those in the highly produced actual play community, emulate a new style of theater. Improvisation, randomization, shared forms of authorship, and participation from an online audience are all relatively new innovations upon a millennia-old practice. And yet, there's little practical difference between Brennan Lee Mulligan dressing up for an episode of Dimension 20, and a 17th century acting troupe donning face paint and costumes before a big show at the Globe. And in that time-honored tradition, I endeavor to make that connection explicit, to use one of the greatest playwrights of the English language in conjunction with a classic and definitive RPG text to achieve the goal that all performances seek, to understand the human condition. William Shakespeare was the author of some 39 plays, and, if no sweat, Shakespeare.com is to be believed, popularizer of over 1,700 new words. Studied in English literature courses across the world, it is practically impossible to use the language without accidentally stumbling upon a turn of phrase alluding to one of his works, or watch a piece of media that doesn't in some way borrow from his legacy. I personally didn't have too much Shakespeare experience before my co-writer, Kara Sertion, pitched this essay to me. But as we plotted to write this, the greatest essay in RPG history, and perhaps the greatest essay in all history, I was delighted to read and analyze what is arguably Shakespeare's greatest play, Hamlet. For the uninitiated, a summary. Hamlet is the Prince of Denmark, who is understandably upset that, one, not only has his father died suddenly, but two, his uncle Claudius has taken over the throne, and three, married his mother Gertrude all in less than 2 months. However, the ghost of his father appears at night and bids Hamlet take revenge on Claudius, who murdered him by dribbling poison in his ear while he slept. Afterwards, Ophelia, a noblewoman who Hamlet is courting, reports to her father Polonius that the prince seems disturbed. Polonius believes this is because he told Ophelia to discourage Hamlet's affection, but when he talks to Hamlet, it's hard to tell if Hamlet is actually mad. Hamlet, seeking to confirm what the ghost told him, hires a troupe of performers to carry out a play in which a man murders his kingly brother and marries his wife. During the performance, Claudius storms off, confirming his guilt in Hamlet's mind. However, Hamlet hesitates to kill Claudius, instead confronting his mom about hooking up with his uncle, which results in Polonius's death, as Hamlet hears him eavesdropping from behind a curtain and stabs him, believing him to be the fratricidal king. Claudius banishes Hamlet to England, but he gets captured by pirates en route and is ransomed back to Denmark. I feel like the plot stuff here is a little silly, but it's fine. Anyway, when he returns, he learns that Ophelia has drowned, a result of her own madness brought on by the death of her father. Her brother Laertes seeks revenge on Hamlet and schemes with Claudius to either kill him in a fencing match with a poisoned sword or trick him into drinking from a poisoned cup. In the final scene, Hamlet is struck by Laertes' poisoned sword, which he then also wounds Laertes with. Queen Gertrude drinks the poisoned cup meant for Hamlet, and when all this treachery is revealed, Hamlet stabs Claudius before succumbing to his wounds. Y'all, this play is wild. You should watch it. There's a free version from 1948 on YouTube. Go watch it and come back when you're done. It's gonna enhance the rest of this essay, I promise. Hamlet, as a narrative, is a deeply compelling tragedy, a a story of revenge and madness, and the ways in which family drives us to do terrible things. Its near-pristine structure and timeless characters made it immediately apparent to me why the story is a classic. What, then, from the world of tabletop RPGs, can compare with such a powerful entry into the storytelling canon? We Are But Worms, a one-word RPG, was written by Taylor LaBrèche and published by Riverhouse Games in 2019. Upon release, it was an instant hit, garnering praise from the likes of Aaron King and the Dice Exploder podcast. I don't think it's a stretch to say that, of any work in the medium of tabletop role-playing games, Worms is the only text that can go toe-to-toe with Hamlet. Those of you who have analyzed Worms already will understand the point I'm making immediately, but the ignorant may have some concerns. Cast them aside. The game's title gives us everything we need to make a comparative analysis of Hamlet, starting with we, and ending with the solitary word that acts as the work's climactic coup de grace. We will give Worms the reading it deserves, the reading that all gamers, and their heart of hearts, already know to be definitive. Hamlet is estimated to have been written around 1601, but its origins stretch back to ancient Scandinavia. When Shakespeare was drafting the play, he took inspiration from an earlier adaptation of the story by Thomas Kidd, but, according to the Royal Shakespeare Company, the plot comes from a real-life event recorded in the Historica Danica, in which a king murdered his brother, married his wife, and then had the dead king's son try to kill him in return. Furthermore, Shakespeare's own young son Hamnet is thought to have influenced the play, as he passed at the age of 11 in 1596. Suffice it to say, the story of Hamlet is one whose very origins are communal, Shakespeare borrowing from Kidd, who in turn borrowed from a historical disastrous family, with Shakespeare reflecting upon his own family's disaster to create the piece. When examining the human condition through the lens of Hamlet and We Are But Worms, it is useful to begin with a call to our shared nature as a species that lives inextricably side by side. Worms encourages this reading by beginning its name with that acknowledgement. It is not I am but worms, but we. Which makes sense. We call them tabletop games because they were traditionally played around a table, sitting across from other people. It is this introspective start that blends Worms so well with Hamlet, because both works, by evoking the communal aspect of their respective mediums, invite metatextual interpretation. To read Hamlet back into Worms, let's examine Hamlet's commentaries on performance and community. Hamlet's madness is an oft-discussed part of the character. I bet everybody watching can at least to some degree associate Hamlet with the image of a skinny white man in a big collar talking to a skull. But until I actually read the play, I didn't understand that Hamlet's madness is performative. In Backwards and Forwards, a technical manual for reading plays, author David Ball points out that Hamlet's famous monologue contemplating suicide is, in fact, not a monologue at all. He's only pretending to be suicidal because he knows that nearby, his shitty Uncle Claudius and weirdo spymaster Polonius are watching, hoping to confirm their suspicion that Ophelia's rejection has made Hamlet crazy. We see this again and again in the first few acts of the play. First, Hamlet's strange behavior towards Ophelia, again when he talks to Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, next in his veiled insults to Polonius, and now when he gives his monologue. But all the while, Hamlet's doing a bit, because he knows full well Polonius is reporting his every move to Claudius. He can't let Claudius know he's onto him, so he's distracting him, letting the king believe his nephew's lost it while Hamlet secretly plots his downfall. This is a big thing for Dr. Ball. Throughout Backwards and Forwards, he chides theoretical directors of Hamlet for not understanding that the Danish prince's affliction is feigned. At the same time, it's understandable why Hamlet has a reputation for madness. He's the only person the ghost will speak with, he constantly plays hot and cold with Ophelia, and crucially, at the moment when the play's body count could be reduced from 8 to 1, he stays his hand. If you're directing a 400-year-old play, perhaps you make the choice to play up that ambiguity, to invite the audience to speculate that there is some madness in the method. Hamlet is putting on a show, but so is the actor playing him. Ball also notes that, quote, family relationships are at or near the center of almost every play, unquote. And when using the communal lens to read Hamlet, it'd be a terrible oversight not to discuss his wicked stepfather. If you've seen The Lion King, By the time you see Claudius appear on stage, you kinda know what his whole deal is. A guy who kills his brother and marries his sister-in-law is a pretty good villain. And looking at Claudius' villainy through a communal lens heightens my appreciation for his narrative arc, how he causes his family's downfall. In the time-honored tradition of royalty, Claudius employs the use of the royal we. According to Mary Norris, writing for The New Yorker, the use of the first-person plural pronoun to represent a single monarch dates back to the 12th century. When a king used we to refer to himself, he was speaking as the representative of God, implying his words were sanctioned by the Lord through birthright. However, when Claudius employs the phrase in Act 1, Scene 2, he's not using it to bolster his standing, but rather to deflect from it.
Though yet of Hamlet, our dear brother's death, the memory be green, and that it us befitted to bear our hearts in grief.
Claudius mourns the dead Hamlet Sr. in a communal sense, embodying the nation when he says that we must bear our hearts in grief. But we had nothing to do with the old king's death. Claudius's conscience is so guilty that he can't help but passively decry responsibility. And this is the first time we hear the king speak in the play. Claudius uses the royal we to absolve himself as soon as he opens his mouth. To psychoanalyze Claudius a bit, wanting to be a king is a pretty understandable ambition, but in my opinion, if you're the brother of the king, your life is already pretty great. All of the privilege of being in the royal family, none of the tedious administration. Why, then, does Claudius feel the need to murder his big brother? We don't get a good sense of Claudius' motivations in the play, but we do know that, besides being a big partier, one of his first acts as monarch was to seduce and marry the former queen. To me, that suggests a much deeper-seated desire for control. Claudius wanted not only to rule Denmark, but to take everything Hamlet Sr. had, including his wife. And ironically, it's this desire to have total control over his family that results in its annihilation. Had he not murdered his brother, had he not married his sister-in-law, had he not arranged for Hamlet Jr. to be executed, he might have kept his grip on the throne. Even in the last act, if he had just trusted Laertes to defeat Hamlet swiftly, and had not insisted upon a backup murder weapon, Gertrude may have survived the final scene. Perhaps, if Claudius, like Worms advises, had viewed his role in a more communal sense, he would not have numbered among the casualties of his need to be in charge. With a single word, Worms provides a sharp critique of game masters who would similarly hoard narrative control. We see this also in Hamlet swearing Horatio et al. To secrecy, an act that may have cost the prince his life. If his friends could only have shared the story of the ghost, Gertrude or Ophelia may have survived till curtain call. Much to consider. However, if we wrap back around to the notion that Worms and Hamlet should be read metatextually, we can also highlight how the medium of theater itself most strongly supports these works' communal themes. The best way to tackle this concept is by looking at the scenes in Act 2 and 3 where Hamlet hires an acting troupe to perform the murder of Gonzago, which is a play that features a murder identical to the one the ghost accuses Claudius of committing. This whole conceit is rife with opportunities to study the play as a commentary on itself, as well as the nature of performance. In this scene, we, the audience, watch a group of performers play William Shakespeare's Hamlet, in which some actors are pretending to be actors, performing a play that has already played out before in Claudius's murder of his brother, while Hamlet himself pretends to be mad. And if that's not enough evidence that there's something going on here about the relationship between audience and actor, Shakespeare addresses us in Act 3, Scene 2, directly.
Oh, it offends me to the very soul to hear a robustious, periwig-pated fellow tear a passion to tatters, to very rags, to split the ears of the groundlings who, for the most part, are capable of nothing but inexplicable dumb shows and noise.
Hamlet's acting advice to the actor is a shot across the bow at the audience. Most of you are idiots who love shouting and spectacle. You are not sophisticated, dorks. I think this is mostly gentle ribbing, but invites the audience to view themselves in the context of participating in the play while they watch it. Are we observing its nuances, or are we just here for the sword fights? Worms 2 asks the same question. Are we here for the gimmick of a one-word game, or is there something deeper we could learn by understanding the text's invitation to participate in understanding itself? And in both, Is participation in the work tacit agreement to what it's trying to accomplish? Now, I don't think that just because you beat Spec Ops the line, you're pro war crimes, but I do think it's an interesting question about engaging with the medium. If you know Hamlet dies at the end, why do you go see the play? Why do you spend a dollar on We Are But Worms when the game tells you it's a one-word RPG? Obviously, watching a tragedy and not storming the stage because you know Hamlet will beef it is not, like, a moral failing. We live in a society. But I do like when a work asks you to reconsider your own engagement with media. Do you play tabletop games because you want to shape the story yourself? If so, why don't you only play solo games? Are you watching a tragedy because you seek catharsis? Or just because you like a bloodbath? I don't think Worms or Hamlet are going to answer those questions for you, but I'm very grateful they're asking. It's important to interrogate our own agency. There might not be a more famous monologue in English theater than Hamlet's soliloquy on suicide. The audience of the play knows that he's only talking like this to fool Claudius and Polonius, but I think it's worth examining the text of the speech. Even though the cause is feigned, we can still glean some insight into Hamlet's beliefs about what it means to be and act in the world. You almost certainly know the first line by heart.
To be or not to be. That is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them, to die, to sleep.
And you know what, Hamlet? I can't blame you there, bud. I have absolutely had days where I'd rather die than get up and push the buttons that make my life roll forward into its agonies. But among students of the play, the theme of this speech, that of wavering between action and oblivion, becomes a defining characteristic of the Danish prince. When the ghost tells him Claudius was his murderer, Hamlet waits to confirm the truth before making his move. When Claudius has his back turned in Act 3, Hamlet hesitates, instead going to confront his mother before killing the king. He swears his friends to secrecy about his plot, he does not bring Ophelia in on his feigned madness, even when he returns from exile, right after he knows Claudius tried to have him executed, he holds off his coup defense with Laertes. At the end of his soliloquy, he laments such passivity.
And thus, the native hue of resolution is sickly dull with the pale cast of thought. And enterprises of great pitch and moment, with this regard their currents turn awry and lose the name of action.
And while we'll get to the high point of Hamlet's lack of action in the next segment, I think it's worth taking the time to see if he's answered the quandary of being or not being. We Are But Worms includes a verb in its title for a reason. It wants the reader to consider themselves in a similar manner. We are. And Hamlet, more often than not, proves that he in fact is. This runs counter to the ways in which other characters perceive Hamlet. Gertrude justifies his strange behavior by conflating it with mourning for his father, Polonius believes Hamlet to be nothing but a love-struck fool, and Claudius thinks Hamlet's little more than a thorn in his side. They attempt to define Hamlet, slapping him with a variety of labels, but they're judging what he is based on their own interpretations of what he does. He puts on the guise of madness to cloak his schemes. He hires the acting troupe to confirm Claudius' guilt. When his continued existence is threatened, he pulls a reversal, exchanging the ordered erasure of his life for that of Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. And at the play's climax, Hamlet takes his long-awaited revenge on Claudius. He does avenge his father, albeit in the sloppiest way imaginable. You can make the argument that Hamlet is only reacting, first to prompting by the ghost, and last by Laertes' revelation that he has minutes to live, but I don't think that's fair. Hamlet's hesitation is brought on by diligence, by methodical planning to take Claudius out without arousing suspicion. The irony, one of the many reasons this play is a tragedy, is that Hamlet's covert of madness is what leads Polonius to investigate him, which leads Hamlet to stab Polonius, which leads Ophelia to drown, which leads Laertes to deliver the fatal blow to our hero. Hamlet acts, but in doing so, resolves the question of his continued being. In the context of a play, these questions of action are especially interesting. the word actor itself is one that, fundamentally, means a person with agency, someone who has the capacity to do. While Hamlet provokes debate about the scope and capacity of its protagonist's ability to act, I think Worms is the perfect complementary text to consider what it means to make change in the world. Whenever I read a game, I take special time to think about the verbs it asks the player to engage with. And in its title, Worms uses a conjugation of the verb to be. Players are primed simply to be. We are but worms. In the context of a conversation about action, what questions does that provoke about playing games? It's not we do but worms. It's not we've been but worms. We just are, in this moment, right now, worms. And that's more or less the point of role-playing, right? Inhabiting a character for fun? Which provokes an additional question. Do role-playing games necessarily require action? In Jose Zagal and Sebastian Dieterding's book, Role-Playing Game Studies, the authors cite a great deal of literature which have tried to establish a succinct answer to the question, what is an RPG anyway? And I think it's fascinating to see the variation in response. There seems to be broad consensus that role-playing involves an imaginary state of embodying someone that is not oneself. However, others specify that action is required, that taking on a role in an imagined world must necessarily involve participating in its creation. And that's a pretty strong stance to take. Does the act of play require action? Worms seems to think so, as no spoilers, but the one word itself is a verb. But when you watch a performance of Hamlet, are you doing more than just passively absorbing the show? Is your engagement with the themes, your remembrance of characters' names and their motivations, enough to constitute action? Or is your watching of the play only a reaction to the actors themselves? Is their work the thing that moves you? And on the other hand, is your willingness to accept the conceit of theater, that the people in front of you can actually embody other characters, a form of role-playing? To quote Johanna Peterson, role-playing is the art of experience. For me, at least, the fun part of role-playing is the play part. It is not enough to be. I need tools, I need verbs. I want to be an actor. I want to shape the world with my biases and perversions. The older I get, the more I realize that I define myself in terms of what I do. I am a writer because I write. I am an indie enthusiast because I read indie games. I am a YouTuber because I crave attention. And when I roleplay, the fun for me comes from imagining a scenario in which I would behave differently from the way I typically do. I want to perform a role. A king may only be king by virtue of being so, but I personally think games are more enjoyable when we are active participants instead of observers. This is why I get so caught up in systems matter conversations, because I believe that the rules and tools a game gives its players fundamentally change the way they act in the imagined world. Though Worms is 29,550 words shorter than Hamlet, it is a game because it provides its audience with the capacity to not simply be, but act. What is the difference between Hamlet and We Are But Worms? When the time for action arrives, Worms does not hesitate. As I read through supplementary material and talked with Caro throughout the writing of this essay, I learned that Hamlet, as a character, is often regarded as a person who cannot make up his mind. Hamlet's fatal flaw is indecision, many would have you believe. And I think, when we are using We Are But Worms as a comparative text, it's useful to meditate on that flaw, as well as the other limitations that result in the play's tragic ending. Themes of responsibility, the trappings of class, and the reasons why we cannot act outside of a small range of options are plentiful in both works. First, why does Hamlet have this reputation for an action? He does, at the end of the play, get the job done, after all. But given that Hamlet is Shakespeare's longest work, there's ample time for our protagonist to dick around. He doesn't initially believe his father's ghost, and spends the first half of the story engineering a convoluted plot to confirm Claudius's guilt. Instead of hatching more concrete schemes, he feigns madness, toying with Ophelia and dunking on Polonius. But I think my favorite scene in the play comes from the moment after Claudius is stormed out, turning his back to Hamlet and praying for forgiveness. He admits his crime to the audience, We know without a doubt he is the killer. And still Hamlet stays his blade.
Now might I do it, Pat. Now he's praying, and now I'll do it. And so he goes to heaven, and so am I revenged. That would be scanned. A villain kills my father, and for that, I, his sole son, do that same villain send to heaven.
I love this so much because of Hamlet's motivations. He doesn't want Claudius to get away with it. Killing him isn't enough. Hamlet needs Claudius to suffer. And so he waits, promising himself that when the time is right, he'll avenge his father with cold steel. But he waits too long. It's not until the time runs out, when Hamlet himself is staring down the barrel of oblivion, that he surges into action. He catches Claudius in the midst of arranging a murder and permitting Gertrude's demise, ensuring his uncle will not go to heaven, but loses his own life in the process. Hamlet's but, his fatal flaw, is just not being quick enough. And that's kind of the fun thing about characters. There are very few characters in literary history that are both perfect and interesting. I personally prefer my protagonists to kinda suck, but even in relatively likable characters, there should still be obstacles to their receiving a happy ending. This is what Worms asks its audience to consider. We are but worms, but in this case, not only calling to mind hesitation, but also limitation. For instance, Ophelia, Hamlet's would-be partner and chart-topper of fictional women who deserve better, largely meets her demise due to circumstance and class. Her father cautions her against Hamlet's courting, both because Ophelia, while a noblewoman, does not hold the same courtly status as a prince, and also because Polonius is a paranoid old weirdo. This is a great bit of ironic storytelling, because while Hamlet comes up with the idea to play mad on his own, it's Polonius who immediately jumps to the conclusion that his madness is the result of Ophelia's rejection. The more Polonius investigates, the more tightly Ophelia is caught up in the scheme to spy on Hamlet. And when Polonius is stabbed to death behind the curtain, Hamlet sets into motion the death of that entire family. Ophelia goes mad out of grief for Polonius's death, but perhaps also because she feels somewhat responsible for Hamlet's condition, which resulted in the murder. Ophelia is a casualty of fate, not noble enough to wed a prince, only sufficiently highborn to receive a standard burial. Things could have been different, but only if Ophelia had been different. She is but a courtier, but a daughter, but a woman. She plays her part, and dies for it. We Are But Worms asks players to come face to face with the limitations inherent in our circumstances. And that's a strong stance to take when writing an RPG. So often, we play games to engage in power fantasies, to make ourselves hotter, stronger, more capable than the people we are in real life. Worms deconstructs these staples of the genre, asking players to consider embodying a role that is in many ways the opposite of why they participate in the hobby in the first place. In doing so, players are invited to reconsider what it means to engage with an RPG entirely. If you, the reader, are but a worm, how does that impact your engagement with an imagined world? You could hardly play a game of dungeon raiding and goblin slaying as a several-inch invertebrate, at least, not the way those games are designed. But that prompts an interesting question. How much are we supposed to engage with a game's setting in history if, like the worm, we have limited understanding of it? For instance, Heart and Spire, two of my favorite games which I wrote extensively about last year, are games that are fundamentally rooted in capital L lore. Classes and moves engage with the fiction of the setting, with the understanding that players are at least somewhat aware of what it means to be a dark elf in a racist city, or to have bees living underneath your skin. But we, the players, have no way of understanding the setting. We are limited by our experience of living in the real world. I think the reasonable response to this quandary is to say, well, I'll read what I can and imagine the rest. Even if I don't know the rulebook front to back, I know what I need and will make everything else up as I go along. This is fundamentally an anti-canon position, a rejection of the author's core vision in place of something new. Worms similarly raises questions about what it means to have system mastery. When I use that term, I'm referring to a comprehensive understanding of how a given game system's rules and mechanics are intended to function during play, generally without having to delve into the text to look them up. If you, the player, are only a worm, even if you've memorized the one word at the heart of the text? Can you truly be said to have system mastery? A worm cannot understand the rules of a game. If you're properly roleplaying, your limitations prevent you from engaging in the work at all. Which leads into the question of why it is important to have rules in the first place, if we are all going to be interpreting a text with varying levels of limitation. I know for a fact that there are people who read D&D and believe it to be the perfect system, while I see a book riddled with shortcomings, warped by the weight of history, economics, culture, and expectation. When me and this straw man run a game of D&D, can either of us be said to have system mastery, if we are both understanding the text from opposite standpoints, despite having read the same words? You get where I'm going with this. Hamlet approaches limitation from a character-driven lens, and Worms approaches it from a philosophical one. The Danish prince lives a tragic life both because of his circumstances as well as his own failings. Worms functions as a commentary on RPGs themselves, obliterating years of blog posts and forum squabbles with its title alone. Both texts ultimately come to the same conclusion. We all do what we can with what we have. We all play the game with the cards we're dealt. The rest is silence. Hamlet is a play absolutely steeped in death. Before the curtains rise, the old king has been murdered, and in the first scene, his ghost comes to cast a pall over the entire production. Hamlet's mad soliloquies often reference dying or suicide, and he is typically dressed in black, mourner's garb to honor his father. 8 characters die over the course of the show, and half of the gruesome murders occur within minutes of curtain call. What makes Hamlet a tragedy is not that all of this death is present, but that it is, theoretically, preventable. But I think what We Are But Worms reminds us is that, despite there being a possible set of actions that might lead to different outcomes, death is not a force that can be outmaneuvered. What makes tragedies powerful as a genre is that even though we as the audience know there should have been another way, the characters themselves are fixed in place, responding and reacting with the only tools at their disposal. We wish that it could end differently, but the worms keep constant vigil. The Lion King is probably the most well-known adaptation of Hamlet for people under the age of 40. We got a son trying to avenge the death of his father, murdered by a wicked uncle, and...
It's written in the stars.
Wait, what are you doing? Are you listening to me?
We'll create a host of little scars.
That. But perhaps the easiest connection Lion King makes with our two comparative texts, its most profound commentary on the cyclical nature of tragedy, is extracted from the earth by an unlikely set of characters. Do you remember the bit where Mufasa takes Simba out to patrol the kingdom and tells him about the cycle of life and death?
When we die, our bodies become the grass, and the antelope eat the grass. And so, we are all connected in the great circle of life.
Later on, when Simba is exiled from Pride Rock, he is rescued by Timon and Pumbaa, a meerkat and warthog who go on to raise the cub into adulthood. But there's a critical bit in Simba's introduction to the Hakuna Matata lifestyle, where Simba learns how to eat like his caretakers.
Oh well, Hakuna Matata. Slimy, yet satisfying.
This scene is the pinnacle of Hamlet criticism, a cinematic revelation so incisive in its insight that I can say without a doubt that it forms the cornerstone of Worm's design. When paired with Mufasa's lesson about the circle of life, we can read this moment as a clear commentary on Act 4, Scene 3 of Hamlet. When Claudius asks for Polonius, Hamlet gives a cryptic reply.
Now, Hamlet, where's Polonius?
At supper.
At supper? Where?
Not where he eats, but where he is eaten. A certain convocation of politic worms are even at him. Your worm is your only emperor for diet. We fat all creatures else to fat us. And we fat ourselves for worms. Your fat king and your lean beggar is but variable service. 2 dishes, but to 1 table, that's the end.
Alas, alas.
A man may fish with the worm that hath eat of a king, and eat of the fish that hath fed of that worm.
What dost thou mean by this?
Nothing, but to show you how a king may go a progress through the guts of a beggar.
Do you not see? LaBrèche has written a text that so fundamentally understands the themes of Hamlet that they've distilled its essence down to a title and one word. Hamlet has turned Polonius into worm food. In The Lion King, Simba eats the worms, which eat the antelopes, which eat the grass, which we know will grow from Mufasa's corpse. The king has passed through the guts of the beggar. There's not more to see. There's nothing more to do. This is the circle of life, as clear as the sapphire sky! These cycles of death and tragedy are so poignant because of their inevitability, because we know that the stars have not favored our characters. Let's work our way backwards through the play. Hamlet himself is the last to fall, having completed the revenge set in motion by his father's shade in Act 1. But remember, his actual cause of death is not hemorrhage, but poisoning. Laertes coated his sword in venom to act out his own revenge on the Danish prince, because he views Hamlet as responsible for the deaths of both Ophelia and Polonius. Hamlet, in his eagerness to avenge his own father, took the life of Polonius, which in turn resulted in Ophelia and Laertes' own deaths. Perhaps Hamlet might have stayed his hand, but remember, he either kills Polonius by accident, or otherwise views him as Claudius' spymaster. Either way, Polonius' death is caught up in Hamlet's call to take vengeance, his strongest character motivation. Hamlet could not escape the duty his father hung around his neck like a noose. Hamlet's death is inevitable. Next comes Laertes, who we honestly know very little about. But from his introduction in the beginning of the play, we know he loves his sister dearly and has great respect for his father. When Claudius lays their demise at the feet of Hamlet, there is no other way for Laertes to respond. Backwards and Forwards makes the point that, in the time Hamlet was being performed, the English had a particular relationship with the Danes, having suffered bloody raids by Denmark for centuries. The audience is meant to understand that the characters in this play are quick to violence and eager to fight. Hamlet initiated a blood feud, and it was answered. Laertes' death is inevitable. Next, Claudius himself. He is damned before the play begins, having already carried out his regicide. His only hope of salvation is secrecy, and he would have gotten away with it too, if it weren't for his meddling nephew and his dead brother's vengeful spirit. But once Hamlet is informed of what Claudius has done, the pretender king's fate is sealed. Claudius' death is inevitable. But immediately before this quick succession of murders is the death of Queen Gertrude, who dies from drinking a poisoned goblet set up as a failsafe to bring Hamlet down. In terms of preventability, Gertrude surely could have found a way out of this. Her death seems almost an afterthought, an extra little sting to pile the corpses higher. She literally just drinks from the wrong cup. But I think her death is inevitable for a couple reasons. First, Claudius' scheming must always backfire. He couldn't pull off Hamlet's senior's murder without getting snitched on. He flubs Rosencrantz and Guildenstern's betrayal. Why should he be successful here? Claudius can only destroy, and when Gertrude hitched her wagon to his star, she ensured that they'd crash and burn together. Second, when I watched the 1948 Hamlet directed by Laurence Olivier, I felt that Gertrude's death was self-inflicted. She can tell something weird is going on, with Claudius being overly friendly to Hamlet, betting pearls on his stepson's victory, and dropping them into this special goblet. Perhaps she, like the audience, realizes this story is coming to a bloody head. She does the only thing she can do to save her son, and takes the poison meant for him in a final act of love. Gertrude's death is inevitable. Several lines earlier in the same scene, we hear Hamlet describe the deaths of Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. They obeyed their wicked king's orders, as loyal, if dim-witted, servants must. Since Claudius is incapable of not fucking up a plan, they unwittingly signed their own bills of execution. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern's deaths are inevitable. Poor Ophelia, I fear, draws the shortest straw in the story. There's no reason for her to die basically at all, and yet, her grief at Polonius' death drags her into a watery grave. I think Ophelia's death is inevitable not because of any character flaw, but because of the narrative in which she is trapped. Ophelia is a pawn, certainly a pawn of Polonius, who uses her as bait again and again to confirm his suspicions about Hamlet. But worse than that, Ophelia is used as motivation for Laertes, the only person who actually manages to inflict a fatal wound on the prince. This is like a feminism 101 level critique, but Ophelia gets fridged. You can see the misogynist undertones of the play in the way Gertrude and Ophelia are treated, even in Hamlet's introduction, "Frailty, thy name is woman." Ophelia's death is inevitable, but only because even 400 years after the writing of this play, we still have a long way to go vis-a-vis writing women in a normal way. And of course, all the way back in Act 3, we have Polonius's death, the event that cascades into all the bloodshed that follows. I think this is one of the easiest deaths to justify, the one that is, outside of Hamlet and Claudius, the most likely to occur. Polonius is a spy. He's an overconfident busybody. He's nosy as shit. His whole deal is elbowing his way into situations he has no right to intervene in. He gives well-intentioned but bad advice to Ophelia about her boyfriend, immediately diagnoses Hamlet with madness with virtually no evidence, and then goes to spy on the boy by hiding in his mom's curtains. Of all the folks who buy it in this play, Polonius is the one who had the most opportunity to stay alive, and the one who gave those opportunities a big fuck you every single time. He's a snoopy spy. He was always going to go out like this. Polonius's death is inevitable. There is, I suppose, one more death we have yet to discuss, that of the old king. It doesn't technically happen during the play, so it's hard to say whether or not it could have truly been prevented. But despite it not occurring on stage, it is the most important death in the whole play. Without Hamlet Sr.'s demise, none of the events of Hamlet ever occur. In some ways, the king's death is the most tragic. Every other character who dies might have been spared if Claudius had not poured poison in the king's ear. That is, of course, the point. The avalanche has already begun before the play starts. There's no way to stop its destruction. As soon as the ghost cries out to Hamlet for vengeance, the prince is a dead man walking. The circle of life must complete its revolution. The king's death motivates Hamlet, who slays Polonius, which maddens Ophelia, which infuriates Laertes, who schemes with Claudius, who poisons Gertrude. Over and over again, character motivations trap them in the narrative, like the opening moves of a chess match, locking the players into a fatal endgame. There's nothing for us to do but sit back and watch the bloodbath. Such is the nature of being born into any particular moment in time. The cycle of tragedy is inescapable. From the day we arrive on the planet, we are but worms. Here we draw our work to a close. I feel all the evidence has been presented, and you, good audience, being of sound mind and virtuous judgment, will agree that there are no two texts better suited for a comparative analysis than Hamlet and We Are But Worms. Both are deeply concerned with the collective experience, the ways in which we perform for others' expectations. Both understand the contradictions of agency and existence, the ways in which we act and fail to act, and the facts of life that prevent us from being all we can be. Lastly, Worms and Hamlet are works consumed by the inevitability of death, both lamenting and accepting its endless cycle. I must again reiterate that this is, in all likelihood, the most important essay ever written about RPGs, and apologize for the earth-shattering revelations which have surely rocked the very core of your being. That said, my email is aaronsxl3@gmail.com, so members of the Nobel Committee may direct their inquiries there. These two works are so densely packed with meaning that we could spend years studying each. Like Hamlet himself, allow us to delay the inevitable by imagining those comparative lenses. Worms uses a bold, blocky typeface, stark white against its colorful background. Is this a statement about striving for oneself, taking up space in a consumption-oriented society which treats the majority of us like children or background decorations? Almost certainly. Furthermore, why are gummy worms used over actual earthworms? Was this a choice made so as to not gross out readers? Or is it a metaphor for the ways we must sugarcoat hard truths about the world, condense them down into something easily digestible in order for us to go about our lives without falling apart? Perhaps. We leave these morsels as our legacy, fragments for future generations to consider. But now inevitability draws near. We may linger for eternity, and still, the wheel turns. For all our analysis and study, all the intricacies of layout and game design, we must still engage with the text itself. We cannot save dear Hamlet, but we can still kill the king with a final thrust, resolve the tension at the game's heart by following LaBrèche's instructions, embodying that one word, the lone syllable which forms the entirety of the text and the backbone of this essay. In the end, we are nothing but worms, doomed to repeat the cycle of violence and decay inherent in our circle of life. We merely are in the moment we find ourselves. How else can we assert that we're alive? There's nothing more to do, my friends, but a ton of people are responsible for this essay existing, and I want to thank them for their contributions. Firstly, thanks so much to Caro Assertion, who was my co-writer and initially pitched using Hamlet as a framing device for Worms. Their outline was so thorough and compelling that I just absolutely had to write it. Much of the text of this essay is actually directly Caro's work, and they're a game design genius. Please check out their games at cexcursion.itch.io. Second, I want to thank all the folks on Aaron Lim's Session Zero Discord server for encouraging me to go along with this prank, especially Juliet Lemieux of Mousewife Games, who both came up with the idea to do a word-by-word analysis of the game, but also gave me a ton of comparative resources to supplement the essay. Also, a big thank you to PsychHound on Tumblr, who actually did the first analysis of Worms I'd ever seen, and inspired this whole video to begin with. I'll link to the post in the transcript, but this doesn't happen if PsychHound hadn't pulled their own prank on their students. Lastly, if you thought this was a fun project, I recommend you check out Riverhouse Games on itch.io. They have much more than just We Are But Worms for sale, so please go ahead and, if you do play the game, go ahead and buy it. If you like this essay and want to help me keep the channel going, you can send me a tip at my Ko-fi in the video description. My background picture is Liquefied Image by Adrian on Unsplash, and my profile picture is by Eater Outsider on Tumblr. If you want to find more of my work, I'm at aavoigt on Blue Sky, Monster Factory fanfic on Tumblr, but my main site is aavoigt.com, where I talk about games and writing. I also do another podcast that's Mortified the Friendship Quest, where me and my friend Layla do critical media analysis. If you want slightly half-baked versions of the stuff, the conversations you see on this channel, I recommend you check out Mortified. Thank you for always watching. You know, this is a big joke, but I did have a lot of fun writing it, and I'm really grateful for all the folks who contributed to it. But we will get back on to more serious video essays in the future, so look forward to that. See ya!